Kate just mentioned, I've been asked to discuss the situation in the Central African Republic, which I'll do in my allotted 20 minutes. I'll start with an overview of the conflict that led to the deployment of MINUSCA, the UN mission in CAR today. I'll then discuss the status of not only current efforts to build the peace in CAR, but also where we have collectively failed to build the peace throughout successive interventions. And then I'll finish with some observations of UNAU cooperation in CAR, given that MINUSCA took over from an earlier AU mission, MISCA. And as you're all emerging leaders in the region here, among the sort of the new challenges and the new threats that you're looking at, there are also new opportunities. And as you know, that there's the last 2 years at the UN have been kind of the season for UN peace operations reform. And one of the big emphasis of this reform process is partnerships, and in particular partnerships with African regional and sub-regional organizations, but partnerships with the AAU in particular. So CAR is a particularly useful case study in UN-AU engagement. So what's the background of the conflict in CAR? Well, I think we all know our geography. CAR lies just where its name suggests, at the landlocked geographic center of the African continent, surrounded by countries that have seen a great deal of violence in recent years: Sudan, Chad, the DRC, South Sudan more recently. But it's important to keep in mind that while CAR's own post-independence history was for a time fairly peaceful, it also brought with it steady economic decline. It's a population of about 5 million people, most of whom speak French and Sango, with a very important minority of Arabic speakers. And that's important when we start talking about the current context. It was once known as the Cinderella of the French Empire because it was a forgotten French colony. Less charitably, some French called it la colonie poubelle, or the trash can colony. So CAR has been either neglected, forgotten, or maligned throughout its history. And it's important to understand that the recent crisis of 2012-2013 did not begin with the Seleka rebellion, and I'll discuss that a bit. Since the 1980s, the Central African Republic has cycled through various low-grade violent rebellions that mostly affected parts of the rural north and then subsided. And we've had repeated regional and sub-regional interventions and interventions by the neighbors, and the violence would decline, and then we would have another cycle of rebellion. This has been the history of CAR for the last 40 years, and a steady economic decline during that period. What changed in late 2012 is that the violence became a full-blown nationwide war that took on Muslim, Christian overtones. Now, the Seleka also was actually a rural rebellion when it first started, and it was not also exclusively Muslim. Everyone associates the Seleka as a rebellion of Muslims. It actually was a rebellion of populations in the hinterlands. Rural communities in CAR were frustrated with the neglect of rural communities, of the peripheries, and with the constant focus on the capital, and repeated promises of DDR, demobilization, disarmament, reintegration programs that never actually came to fruition. And this frustration was both against political elites, Central African political elites in Bangui, but also frustration with the international community that seemed to not be able to see beyond the capital and beyond engagement with the political elites in Bangui. And so I know you've been talking about state society relationships throughout your sessions. This is an important case of the rural peripheries rising up, and that was actually the spark that that began the 2012-2013 descent into violence. It later took on, as I said, Muslim-Christian overtones, the Seleka, which is not the Seleka. There are many Selekas. It's fragmented and has realigned, is now almost exclusively Muslim. In late 2013, the French sent in a French force, Sangaris, to help shore up MISCA, which was the African Union force that was in CAR, until the UN Security Council could deploy MINUSCA, which it did in 2014, and now has an authorized force of about 12,000 peacekeepers. Now, again, as I mentioned, the UN mission is just, this UN mission is just the latest in a string of more than a dozen international interventions in CAR since the mid-1990s. And these are UN interventions, African Union interventions, and sub-regional in interventions. So starting in the 90s, violence became a dominant rather than an intermittent form of political maneuvering in CAR. And so what we've seen in CAR is a long history now of stewardship alternating for successive conflict management interventions, alternating between the international community outside the region and the region and sub-region. So for example, in 2002, CEMAC, the Economic and Monetary Community of Central African States, deployed what was known as FOMUC, as a multinational force. In 2008, ECAS assumed control of FOMUC and deployed MICOPAX. In 2013, the AU deployed MISCA, which replaced MICOPAX. And in 2014, the UN deployed MINUSCA, which replaced, was a handover from MINUSCA, and that's what we have to this day. And this is not counting UN peacebuilding interventions and regional peacebuilding interventions. These are merely the peacekeeping operations that have been deployed in the country. So you see, there's been a long history of interventions to stem the violence in CAR. So today, a quarter of the population of the Central African Republic has been displaced. Thousands have been killed. 95% of the Muslim population in the Central African Republic is either internally displaced or are refugeed in Cameroon and in Chad, which is where many of them actually trace their family lineages to. We've had elections in CAR. We have a new government that is marginally more legitimate than the last one, but is struggling, and we're seeing the violence escalate again. The mission, the UN mission, as you I'm sure all know and have read about, has been plagued with sex abuse scandals, and it's also seen as biased by just about everyone in CAR. Part of that is par for the course for any UN peacekeeping operation, but MINUSCA is one expects it with a longer UN mission like MINUSCA. It's been around for 18 years, but it's striking that there is such a lack of confidence in the UN peacekeeping mission in CAR by all sides to the conflict, given its youth, shall we say. So how could things have gotten so bad, and why, despite all of these interventions, has the situation in CAR gotten progressively worse? Well, let me highlight just a few lessons. If we look historically at some of the missed opportunities across these various interventions over the years. First, policymakers have chronically failed to understand CAR's actual challenges. They have, as a result, had trouble understanding and responding to the increasingly militarized politics that have dominated CAR over the past 20 years. Again and again, interventions in CAR have failed, in part because those leading them have operated as if the crisis of the moment was the first of its kind. And in fact, what it is just the most recent cycle of a long process of violence and decline. So a better understanding of CAR's history reveals that the recent violence is less of an aberration than the label crisis, which suggests, which implies an abnormality, might lead us to assume. It is, this crisis is about 40 years in the making. So it did not begin in 2012. A second sort of shortcoming in the way interveners have approached CAR has been the tendency to understand CAR through narratives developed elsewhere. So, for example, one approach has been that it's been a spillover from Darfur, that the conflict in CAR is spillover from Darfur. Well, it isn't. Often the historical connections with CAR's southern partners, like the DRC, have been ignored. The International Criminal Court's first and so far only case on CAR is more about DRC and prosecuting sexual violence crimes than it is about CAR. And the case in question is the one that successfully prosecuted Jean-Pierre Bemba, who's a Congolese, was in fact one of the vice presidents and a former rebel leader of Congo for crimes committed in CAR. That case had actually more of an impact in Congo than it's had in CAR. The huge investments in fighting the LRA in CAR have been more over the years, more about U.S. counterterrorism policy in the region than President Bozize at the time, his interest in having U.S. assistance, than what the LRA was actually doing in CAR at the time. There were armed groups in CAR that were committing a lot more violence in CAR than the LRA was at the time. There are countless of examples. A year ago, a Washington Post article equated Seleka, described the Seleka as Islamist rebels, equating them with Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda in the Maghreb, and others, which they're not. And part of what is concerning is that reading a particular conflict through narratives developed elsewhere not only misreads what you're trying to understand, but it can also be a self-fulfilling prophecy, especially in CAR, where the current violence is using the idiom of religion, and thus appears on the surface to be a religious conflict between Christians and Muslims, but this is really a long-standing conflict about identity, citizenship, and belonging. And it's taking now. It's taking the form of what appears on the surface as a religious conflict. Another shortcoming is one can make this argument in for other cases, but the Central African State in particular can only be understood as part of a broader system of historical relationships within CAR, within the region, and beyond. So understanding the nature of relationship within CAR's borders and beyond are key to understanding the core dynamics of governance in the CAR. So CAR has been called a periphery of a periphery. This was Dennis Cordell, an anthropologist, years ago, called it a periphery of a periphery. But the reality is that even peripheries are centers of something, right? So what we see in CAR is a complex hive of competing authorities across the region that are born of specific historical relationships and dynamics. So the region matters. The region, the immediate neighbors are hugely important and have relationships with communities inside CAR, historic relationships. So it's important to understand these border crossing dynamics. For example, these cross-regional connections have shaped the lives of Muslims in Central African society. It's and even though they the Muslim community is largely born and raised in CAR. As I said, they trace the lineages back to Chad and Cameroon, and the neighbors have been very much involved in governance, day-to-day governance, even in CAR. And this is related to the fact that the Central African State has always been privatized. Huge parts of CAR's economy have historically been contracted out. So the French basically, rather than during the colonial period, rather than develop an administration, they leased the territory out to private companies to run. So, and in fact, we're seeing this subcontracting, this concessionary politics in CAR to this day, where everything, including governance, is contracted out, either to the UN, to international NGOs. I mean, MSF basically runs all of the medical facilities outside of Bangui. So so external actors, as I said, play a very important role in daily governance in CAR. And just to give you a stark example, in January 2014, when President Déby of Chad became frustrated with the CAR government of the day, he summoned and airlifted the entire CAR government to N'Djamena, where a new transitional president of the Central African Republic was selected, and then everybody was flown back to Bangui. So, a lot of the decisions about what happens in Central African Republic happen in N'Djamena, in Paris, in Nairobi, in New York, in Brussels. Finally, none of the interventions profited from periods of peace to build the necessary infrastructure, whether it's medical institutions or others. And this is a huge, what I call a colossal failure of peace building, because that's when it's in between the peaks of violence where this work needs to be done. And what we're seeing is that we keep repeating old formulas that haven't worked, which is in CAR, it's the formula of a national dialogue, elections, the promise of DDR, and then donors run for the exits. And it's a formula we've seen again and again. Now, just I'll end with some observations on the region's cooperation with the UN, given these multiple handovers. As I mentioned, there's been a proliferation of peace missions in CAR, and the result was that each new intervention of a peacekeeping force was an added layer on the one before, as opposed to being thought through strategically in a new way. So with every handover, the new mission inherited the troops and the and in fact the challenges of the previous mission. The sex abuse problems are also the result of this layered rehatting, because there was insufficient vetting and so on. So, in terms of an example of AU handover to the UN, the transition was smooth. There was good coordination between the heads of MISCA and MINUSCA. They met on a weekly basis. It helped streamline a transition process. And there was a presence of a UN team working together with the MISCA team. But what we've seen, and this is emblematic of peace operations in the region, I think, is that with ECAS, the AU, the UN, France's involvement, and changing leadership, what we saw was a great deal of confusion. There was no clarity of who was in charge, at least from a political standpoint. So this lack of leadership clarity also created a lack of clear political goals, which impacted the relationship with the transitional government and the expectations of the government. So when we're talking about rehatting, that's what I'm saying, that this is important moving forward as we start talking about UNAU partnerships and rehatting. We need to pay more attention to how this is done and not just simply rehat. You know, the implicit model of AU-UN partnerships thus far in peace operations is that the AU serves as this first responder and until either some modicum of stabilization has been achieved or until the UN is ready to deploy. But we might also need to start considering rehatting in the other direction, right? The UN handing over to the AU, and this raises the issue of political leadership. MISCA was purely a military force; its political dimension was marginal. And neither the UN or the AU focused or prioritized the economics and financial issues in CAR. So this lack of political leadership points to, I think, a bigger problem within the AU in synchronizing the political and military branches. The AU's role has been, at least in CAR and elsewhere, mostly to provide foot soldiers, while the political analysis is left to the UN. MISCA never played a strong political role, nor was it recognized as a leading political actor in the resolution of the crisis. So this raises the question: who gets to define the conflict? The AU is weak on analysis, despite a huge capacity in the region for conflict analysis. The UN analysis is completely fragmented problematic for other reasons. So who then assumes the political leadership in the region for managing these conflicts? And related to that, of course, is the how do we manage the RECs, the sub-regional organizations. Some friends in the AU jokingly refer to the RECs as the WRECKS, the RECs, because they find them that they're more of a headache than they. So where does the leadership, the political leadership, lie in these partnerships? We all focus on financing and financial constraints as a big challenge. It is. MISCA suffered from financial constraints, but we also need to understand and start thinking about where. Who takes on the political leadership in these operations? So I'll leave it there. Thank you.